Okay, so welcome to the fourth lecture of the selected topics in graph theory. Problems about tutorials we'll be discussing during the tutorial, maybe at the end of the lectures. Maybe let's go over the lecture. So this is so today we are going to do a big theorem called the grid Minor Theorem. Essentially, the lecture will be mostly one big proof. So consider yourself warned. Yep. So let us do a quick recap what we discussed in the last lectures. We have the definition of the tree weave, which was like a way of sweeping or like sweeping the graph using bags, small bags. So there's like a tree-shaped way of expressing the graph as bags. I mean, this was like the intuition of sweeping. That's like it goes over the, like somehow like sweeps, like the researchers, cops looking for a robber in a graph. And we had properties like it covers the entire graph and covers the entire or edges, every edge is some bag, and the guy has got connected, every vertex appears in a connected set of bags. And the quality measure of a decomposition was like the width minus one, just to have that the forests have got width one. I mean, the optimum decomposition of forests has got width one. Tree width was the width of the minimum possible width of a tree decomposition. And the important property that we got was that if you look at an edge of the composition like this one, and if you look at the vertices appearing on the left in the one box, on the other box, and in the intersection, then this intersection actually separates the vertices appearing on the left from the vertices appearing on the right. And this like expressed on this in this example, that G and I separate the red vertices, the guys that appear on the red box, from the blue vertices, the guys that appear on the blue in the blue box. Okay, so that's the main property that we used quite a lot and we're using still. And we were asking ourselves the question that was like the end of the lecture like 2 weeks ago and most of the previous lecture. I mean, okay, so 3D composition, sometimes the width is small, sometimes width is high. And the question is like, what makes width high? And like, what's the certificate that the true width is high? And the first thing we did 2 weeks ago was an observation. I sketched an approximation algorithm for Bertson-Seymour. And there was the moment, the intuition was that, I mean, the thing we observed there is that the place where the algorithm doesn't make a progress is when it encounters something called like a well-link set. So the picture was like follows. So there's a set X, this is well-linked. If you cannot make a separation, so you cannot partition the graph into a partition, but like say have two sets, say red and gray, looking like that, so that this is set A, this is set B, there are no edges from here to here, so the edges can be only like that, okay? And both A intersection B, like this is the order of the separation, yeah, this thing that separates the left side from the right side, this is strictly smaller than both X intersection A and X intersection B, yeah? So if you look here, if I take the orange thing, like this area is larger than, a separation, this cannot happen. Like a separation where what you cut in the middle, the gray part you cut in the middle, the gray cut you cut in the middle is strictly smaller than the part of the X that remains on the left and the part on, that remains on the right. And here we count also the guys from the intersection. Okay. And yeah, so this was like forbidden, this welling said that if this doesn't happen. And yeah, so, and we observed that actually there was a specific case when we encountered actual welling set in the part of the graph that we didn't decompose yet. And that was a large enough welling set was an obstacle to truth because, I mean, we proved really this once. I mean, if you look at the numbers that the welling set of size 3k plus 3 forces you to have truth larger than k, at least k, so bugs larger than k. And if you don't have any welling sets, then the Robertson-Seymour decomposition will compute through the composition of some sufficiently narrow width. Okay, so that's yeah, that's what we had in the what we discussed 2 weeks ago. And then last week I presented the notion of the bramber, that was like a family of connected subgraphs that pairwise touch, where touching means overlapping or having a mesh between them. And the quality measure of a bramble is not the size, but the minimum hitting set size. So how many vertices you need to hit, nail, to hit all the guys from the bramble. And the bramble is sort of like a fuzzy clique. I mean, you can reuse every vertex thing, but it looks like a quick hick minor, really. You can reuse every vertex many times, but the quality measure is the hicking set. And we had an observation that any tree decomposition needs to contain a back hitting a bramble. So the order of the bramble cannot exceed tree of the graph, or tree plus one, actually. And there was a quite complicated proof last time that actually this is tight. Like the bramble is like the tight obstacle for tree. That, I mean, the maximum order of a bramble is exactly one plus tree. So it cannot be larger because the film tree decomposition contains a back hitting a bramble for every bramble. But in the other direction, you can always find the bramble. It was really like this proof was had this intuition. It was quite technical, but the intuition was that these pieces of the graph where the like naive process of decomposing the graph stops, this pieces of the graph form a good element of the bramble, and you can argue that they're really in the same place of the graph if you take a minimum of happy there. Okay, so that was really what we did last week. And now, yeah, so, and we discussed in on site grids. So this is a grid, grid. And then n times n means like how many rows of vertices and how many columns of vertices there are, this notation here. And we discussed in the last tutorial that the path width in Hilgerith is at most n because there was a decomposition with bags of size n plus one. I mean, we discussed in the last tutorial. And we also discussed on last lecture that there's a bramble, like if you take for every I and j, you take the row I plus column j as a set aij. Yeah, so you take some column, you take some row, and you take it over all ij, I mean, like n square sets, then this is a bramble of order n. Yeah, this is what we discussed last time. So true if it's at least a minus one, because there's a bramble of order n. And I hand wave that you can improve the bramble, but that's technical and I don't want to do it. So I'm not doing it, but the truth is actually equals n. So you can, I mean, the path decomposition, tree decomposition we had is optimal. You can get a slightly better bramble, but that's not really insightful how you get it. So the truth actually equals n. Okay, so that's what we had. And so what, to sum up what we discussed so far is that if a graph we know that has got large tree, we can find a narrow tree decomposition. We had that there's a bramble of high order, actually exactly one plus tree. Okay. We had a large Y-link set because the Robertson-Singer approximation algorithm cannot find too narrow decomposition. I mean, this is like a constant factor of tree. But if you think about it, these are both quite abstract objects. I mean, bramble is a very high abstract object. Actually, we discussed that if you want the bramble that's whose order is very close to the order of the tree, you may need an exponential size bramble. And for Welling set, it's also like Welling set is sort of an abstract object if you think about it. So maybe there's some like very concrete reason. Maybe you can find some much more like evident reason for a tree. And if you think about it, like because taking minors that cannot increase truth, then maybe if truth is high, maybe there's like a minor who has got high truth and it's like clearly that has high truth, like a clique. Yeah. If you have got a k vertex clique as a minor, your truth is at least k minus one. Yeah. But it's not true. I mean, a grid is an example that you can have high truth. I mean, larger and larger grids have higher and higher truth, but they cannot have k5 as a minor. Yeah, because K5 is not planar and the grid is a planar. And whenever you contract something, you still have a planar graph. So all minors of grids are planar, so they don't have K5 as a minor. And, but I mean, they have got high truth. So like you don't necessarily contain a large clique as a minor if you have got high truth. So there is no like clique obstacle. But maybe there's another obstacle. And the question is like, okay, but grids are another graphs that are like clearly of high truth. And this is the topic of this lecture. Like, if we have got high truth, do we need to have a high grid as a minor? So of course, I mean, it won't be a subgraph because if you subdivide every edge a few times, you have got essentially the same truth. I mean, exactly the same truth, except for some super stupid cases. Then you don't have a grid as a subgraph because your graph, your minimum cycle is long, but maybe you have got a grid as a minor. Okay, and that's actually true, and that's a deep theorem that was first proven by Robertson-Seymour. I think I didn't check exactly one of the papers, but let's say it's like late 80s, I believe, but I didn't check it exactly, so maybe I'm wrong here. So this is like saying that there is some dependency. Like if there if you want a grid k by k grid as a minor, there is some true bound f of k that forces you to have k by k grid minor. Yeah. So that wasn't true for cliques, because you can have arbitrary large tree for a grid and missing k5. Yeah. But here, I mean, if you want larger and larger grids, you can have higher and higher tree, but this f of k can explode very quickly. And in the original proof, it explodes very quickly. And then in late 90s, there's a proof of Distel et al. Where that gives like an explicit bound of 2 to the poly. I think this poly is like k to the 5 really here, this proof, but 2 to the polynomial of k. And the proof is understandable. And this is the thing that we'll be discussing here for the last hour of the lecture. Like, this is the proof you will see today. Maybe with some small details slipped on the rug, but nothing substantial on it. So this is the proof that's presentable within an hour and a bit on such a lecture. Okay. Then there was a question, okay, how low can you get? Can you get the polynomial? And I think around 2015, so this is like late 90s, and now around 2015, Chakuri and Chuzoy gave a proof of polynomial. I think in the first version, it was like something like k to the 100. And the reason how they succeeded and the previous ones didn't succeed in getting a polynomial, because it was a bigger open problem for a while in the area, was that they managed to understand things from approximation algorithms for disjoint path problems. So there was like a line of research in the algorithm about disjoint path problems, approximating like the number of disjoint paths you can connect some terminals. And actually there was quite a lot of national area of tools developed there, and it turned to be useful for constructing grids as well. So it turned out to be close. And they were like skilled, and they brought like a toolbox from neighboring area here and got a polynomial. And then Yulia Chuzoy and like our collaborators went into improving the bound, and the current best bound, to the best of my knowledge, is k to the 9 times sine polylogarithmic factors. I think this is like 2 years old proof. 2 years old proof. Yeah. So this is the best we know so far. Right? K to the 9 times sine polylog for the grid minor theorem. And a good question is like, how good can you get here? If you think about it, well. If you look at a clique, I mean, the point is what stops you from having f very close. Of course, f of k maybe, I mean, probably even up to k. I mean, because the trivial of the grid sum is like n by n grid is n. But if you think about it, grid has got this problem of having like quadratic number of vertices in the tree. And there are graph that has got linear tree in number of vertices, like cliques. Yeah. So in a clique, the tree is n minus 1, but you have got only n vertices, so you won't find a grid larger than root n times root n, because you run out of vertices, yeah? So this is like a sort of, I mean, silly reason, but like, I mean, the grid has got this quadratic number of vertices, so you can avoid it. So this function f needs to be quadratic, yeah? Because for grids, you cannot hope for a grid better than root n by root n. And you can slightly improve this argument. If you take a random n vertex constant degree graph, or actually any constant degree expander that we'll discuss later in this lecture, and the last few lectures, Michał will be lecturing about expanders, then the truth is linear. I mean, a random n vertex constant degree graph has a linear truth with high probability, just because it doesn't have a balanced separations of small order. I mean, all the balanced separators will have linear size. So that forces truth to be high. And you can also argue, because the grid is very specific about which vertex connects to which vertex, you will need log n vertices on average to make the connections. I mean, that's a non-trivial fact. I mean, I'm just hand waving. The intuition is that because in the random things, I mean, and you, at some point when you start building a grid, you're very constrained what we want to connect now to which. If we find out that you will need on average log n vertices to really connect the things you want to connect at that moment. So a branch set will require log n vertices. So you are even like more constrained on the vertices. You're not only having like true if linear number of vertices, but every branch set of your grid requires log n vertices. So this gives like f of k being k squared, at least like k squared log k. So it's like, I mean, from the simple example of clique, you can like squeeze another log k by changing a clique to a constant degree expander. Okay, so this is it, and this is the best we know from the lower bounds. I mean, actually, I think I had at least once or twice some experts in the area saying that actually maybe this is the correct answer, that actually it's hard to get a better lower bound, that maybe the grid minus theorem should have k squared log k in the end, but we seem far in our toolbox to proving it. Actually, it's constructing this grid is really difficult. So there's a gap between k to the 9 polylog and k squared log k. We don't know what's the correct answer there. Okay. Okay, so that's a high level story. And now we go to proving something. And this is the this version. We're going to prove this version. I think the journal version is 1999. Of course, it was like developed in the previous years and probably announced a bit earlier. But like the journal version, I think, is 99. And this is the proof that's actually within this remaining 70 minutes should be presentable. And we see how it goes. At least it was presentable on the previous few editions of this lecture. Okay. So how do we go about it? So let's start with the our starting point. I mean, we have got brambles that were quite complicated, but I mean, we still have got like this bed dependency. So we the brambles were interesting because they were really tight. So the better point of view, like the more less abstract thing, is actually this Welling set. So we'll be looking at this Welling set, and let's us recall how it worked. And I want to slightly rephrase this approximation algorithm we had previously. So what I want to have here is that I want to have like in the same spirit as for the brambles we did this attempt. So let's look at this. I want to look at this Robertson similar decomposition as follows. So it makes it grows bigger and bigger decomposition. So it has got some a parameter k that it aims at. Okay. And it has got like something like maximum adhesion size, how much it grows the adhesion size. And this is A, which was something like 3K plus something, let's call it 3K plus six. I mean, I'm so sloppy for a reason on this additive constant up there. And there was like a maximum bug size that we allowed. It was something like 4K plus eight or something like that. Okay, so it had these parameters and it built the tree decomposition of the graph, which we may call an attempt last the previous lecture, so that all non-leaves for every non-leaf t, we have got that the bug is already small, it's smaller than b, okay, but also for non-leaf, but for some leaves, I mean, if a leaf is too large. Then we want the adhesion. Then this beta of t intersection the parent. Let's call it beta p prime. So it's like t and t prime. Okay. I mean the adhesion is small. I mean we want it to be like the intersection from the previous bug is small. And you can also have this extra properties we had on the we discussed on the previous things like the same. In the previous lecture, that there are small technical massages that you can also assume that beta of t minus beta of t prime is connected. Yeah, because otherwise you can split into few leaves, like every leaf contains the connected component, different connected component and the intersection, the adhesion. And also you can assume that beta of t intersection, beta of t prime is the neighborhood of beta of t minus beta of t prime. Yeah, that the things that are copied from the parent are the neighbors because you don't need any other vertices. I mean, you need the neighbors to cover the edges, so they need to be there, but you don't need any other vertices. You can forget them in the leaf. They're already like decomposed earlier. So they're already handled there. You don't need it. I mean, these were the two things that were in the brambles and here are exactly the same. So I don't repeat exactly the arguments there. Okay. And now we want to make a progress up there. So what we looked up there, what we looked is that we looked at this, this is beta of t minus beta of t prime, okay? And this is the intersection, beta of t intersection, beta of t prime. And this is the rest of the graph, yeah? And now the point was as follows, yeah? So what we could do the following. There was the first case, I mean, I will write it here with orange. The first case is the, if this adhesion, let's call it A, if this adhesion, actually this is wrong, x, that's x. If the x is strictly smaller than a, okay? If this is strictly smaller than a, you can add an extra vertex. So what you can do, you can add an extra vertex here, okay? Add an extra vertex. So make a child, so take a vertex v here and make a child with beta of t intersection beta of t prime and v as a bug, okay? And then this make like t prime with this bug, and add t prime with this bug and have t below it. And now with this t, if you look back to this, to these assumptions, then this cleaning arguments for these assumptions will actually kick in, so that you'll actually forget the guys from this bug that don't have any more neighbors in this undecomposed part. And if this undecomposed part is a few connected components, it will split into a few leaves. Okay, so that was like one step of this Robertson-Seymour. And the other step of the Robertson-Seymour, let's make it blue, was that if size of X was equal to A, what it did, okay, it said, hey, I want to look for the separations. I want to look at this graph, beta of T. And I was like, I'm looking for a separation that contradicts the fact that X is well linked in B. So X not well linked in G of beta of T. Yeah. So I want to look at the separation that contradicts it. So, I mean, because if this set is too large, I argued that compared to true, if that was the argument up there, if the set is much larger than true, then it needs to have got, then it cannot be well linked. And there was another argument up there two weeks ago. So there was like, so I can find a separation, a gray set and an green set. Okay. And now the point is that we create a bug with like the new bug, the yellow thing, the new bug contains the previous adhesion and the intersection, the separation. This is the yellow is the new bug. And now you have got one child containing this part with this yellow neighborhood and the second child containing this bug. Yeah, and now, I mean, you can argue that, okay, maybe, okay, if I phrase it like that, this should be like something like 4.5. This should be like, here it should be 4.5 really plus 9, because because maybe the separation really splits the adhesion into 2 equal halves, but whatever, I phrase it slightly different previously, but you can think in this term, in this manner here. And yeah, so if there's a separation that splits, like contradicts the fact that this guy is well linked in beta of t, then you can make a progress by having this yellow area as a bug and splitting it to one and two as a as children, as two children as bug. And this is like a progress. This is like how this Robertson-Seymour can view as a Robertson-Seymour decomposition algorithm. So the moment when this algorithm stops to work is this moment when it hits this case two, and suddenly this X is well linked in beta of t. Okay, this is the one when it stops, and now we want to like use it. So we say, okay, the guy has high truth, so we run this Robertson-Seymour approximation algorithms for like slightly too small truth, so that shouldn't create a tree decomposition. So it, if it doesn't cannot create a decomposition, it needs to at some point hit a well-linked set. Okay, but I want to augment this process a bit, and I run out of slide, but let me just argue about it. I want to augment this process a bit with I want to build when I progress into some direction, I want to build a skeleton of what I beat for. I mean, this will be useful later. So what I want here, okay, I will draw a picture up there. So there was like this, I mean, let me draw it like that. There was this intersection here and this beta of t, okay? And I want, okay, so intersection is well linked in B. So this is like now called B, okay? And this is like the rest is A, the other part of the graph is A, okay? So this is like the separation we constructed. I mean, this is really this leaf that the Robertson-Seymour approximation algorithm stopped at that moment. And what I want to say is that I want to take a red color and inside A, I want a tree. That it's not necessarily a spanning tree. I want a tree here that will be subcubic, maximum degree at most 3, okay? But it will span all these guys here. It will span all these guys here with the properties. I mean, it will span all the guys here. That's the thing I want to have here. But in order to push the induction and construct these trees, I want these guys here to be of degree at most 2 inside this inside intersection. They cannot be branching vertices here. And I want at least one orange guy here that's of degree 1 and has got a neighbor in B. I mean, okay, everybody here has a neighbor in B. That's like There's around the degree one guy that sticks up there. So I want for every, so like, so in this process of constructing this the tree that comes off Robertson Seymour, I want to maintain that for every leaf that I'm still want to decompose something inside, that I still want to decompose something inside, then, I mean, on the like other side of the leaf, I want to maintain such a tree, okay? This tree will be useful later for construction, will be like part of the grid or whatever we are reconstructing, okay? And I want to argue that you can do it just as follows. So if you are, so let's go over Robertson-Seymour decomposition algorithm and let's say that, I mean, I can always maintain such a tree for every leaf, okay? So the Robertson-Seymour approximation algorithm has got two steps. I mean, I start with say single vertex as the decomposed part, and then the single vertex is the this tree up there. So that's the starting is easy. The difficult part is like to go over the steps. So the steps was either this was too small and we picked a new vertex and added it to adhesion, like added it to a bug and went further. That was one of the ways how Robertson-Seymour progresses. And here we can modify it. And here we actually use this, like this decomposition, there's one guy of degree one. Okay, that there's actually one guy of degree one in the adhesion in this tree, because what we can do, we can take a neighbor of this guy as this vertex, sorry, as this vertex U, that as this vertex that you add to adhesion. Okay, there was on the previous slide, there was this orange guy V that, okay, it was P, maybe I should call it U, that you add to adhesion, that you add to adhesion and progress in the first case. And here I want to, I mean, in previous one, it doesn't matter which one we take. Here I want to take the neighbor of the degree one from the adhesion, okay? Degree one in the tree. And now the point is that now this guy becomes the degree one guy in the adhesion. And here we use the cleaning step that actually this part is connected because now U is incident to something more in this part up there, okay? So I can extend this tree by this edge and like now proclaim that this is the guy, the degree one guy that's like suitable for extending. Okay, so this is how I, in this process, I keep this tree. And also we had this other operation that there was actually a separation. This could be, there could be this separation. I'll draw it both in gray with this one added to the back. And now we split into this part and this part, okay? And what I want to say here is that now I can take the separation to be the minimum order such separation, or I can actually, it's sufficient for me so that this separator I pick here is actually a minimum separator between this area and this area. Yeah, I can without loss of generality assume that this guy is a minimum separation between these areas, which means by the Minor Theorem that there's actually a flow from here to here, saturating all the guys here. There's a flow saturating all the guys here. Okay, that there's actually a flow saturating all these guys here. And this flow, I mean, now if I recurse, say, into the second child, so let's look at the recursion into the child two. So this is child two. What the child two gets this one as the thing to be decomposed, gets this area as the thing to be decomposed. And now I can take the tree I had, the red tree I had before, and add this flow paths up there. Add the flow paths, that's like, let's make it red. Add the flow paths up here, okay? This flow paths in part one. I can add the flow paths in part one to the tree, and now, because now these guys become degree one guys, so there's this one degree one guy that has got a neighbor in two, and these guys here have got maximum degree three, because they used to have maximum degree two, and they got at most one flow path attached to them in this process. Okay, so I maintain the tree of maximum degree three, and I maintain at least these guys of degree, actually these new guys have got degree one here, and yeah, so that's how it, yeah, so it's actually at least one of them is so degree one, because you made a progress. There's something in the separation here that you pushed flow to. Okay, so this is how I maintain this tree. This is like a technical step, but what we get, I mean, we get this lemma. I mean, now let me change the picture. I mean, the change, let me wipe out from the statement of this lemma the things that we used only to push the induction. But really, what's really important here is that we got this part that was, I think, blue previously, that was called B, and there was part, let's make it red now, that was A, okay? Okay, and this area, this area is large, okay? This area is large, and on the A side, there is now, there's a tree, which is a subcubic tree that spans all the vertices here. Okay, and I no longer care now. I mean, it was useful for induction that these guys have a degree at most two and that one of them has degree one, but now I don't care about it like any longer. Okay, I have got like on I side, I have got the spanning subcubic spanning tree spanning all the guys here, and on the B side, the guy is well linked. On the B side, this intersection is well linked. Okay, that's the picture I got, and now I want to use it. I mean, this is my starting point for construction. I want to use on one side this tree for some connections, on the other side, this set B for some other connections and get a grid by this way. So how do I proceed with that? Okay, so how do I proceed with that? Well, I want now to use this tree for connections, but I want these connections to be disjoint, okay, vertex disjoint. I want to use this tree for some connections and I want them to be vertex disjoint. And that's the reason why I kept track of having this tree of maximum degree three, because if I don't care about maximum degree, I could just take a spanning tree of site A or something like that and just keep it connected. Yeah. But I was really taking care in what I said on the previous slide to have maximum degree three. So I want to have got, and now the observation is that if I have got a guy of maximum degree three, okay, let me show what I want to say here. If I have, so if you look at this tree, some of the vertices of this tree are the vertices of the intersection. So let's, the circles are the vertices of the intersection A intersection B, okay? And there are a lot of them, okay? And now what I want to say is that I want to evenly partition them into M pieces. M is some parameter that we'll choose in a moment, okay? So I have got some M and I want to partition them into, I want to like take gray set and I want to kill a few edges from this tree. So that if you split this, killing an edge from a tree splits into two connected components, okay? And I want to split roughly evenly the elements of A intersection B. And if you think about it, this is, I mean, it won't be possible if the tree is a star with all the leaves being in A intersection B, because like now cutting an edge separates only one, but if you have got maximum degree three, it's actually is actually simple. Yeah, like you take, you root this tree somewhere and you take the lowest edge where the number of A intersection B guys is at least 1/m fraction or roughly 1/m fraction of all of them. And you can argue that actually it's like between what you wanted and twice of what you wanted. Yeah, that you have got like a grand variety too, because every guy has got only two children. So like if two children are too small, then the next edge is like only twice too small, plus maybe this extra vertex, yeah? So this roughly means up to factor two. So you can actually argue that you can partition, I mean, I'm not doing the exact details, but this simple lemma that you can delete m minus one edges so that each piece has got roughly the same number of elements from A intersection B, roughly means up to factor two. And maybe there's some loss at the end. So maybe some of them is slightly larger because there's some remainder at the end. Okay, so they're roughly of the same size, which means essentially means that all of them are really large. Okay, so I partitioned, I removed M minus, so the tree T split into M trees, and each of these three has got large intersection with this intersection. And I need this large intersection because I will use well-linked setness to make some flows, to make some disjoint paths up there, okay, in the B side. So what does it mean? So if original was large, then every like intersection of this tree with A intersection B is large. I mean, because we split them roughly evenly, that's the only place when we use the fact that we split them evenly. And the point is that now, if I have got one of these trees here, okay, and another of these trees here, and this is this blue part up here, and this is like AI, and this is AJ, they're both large. And this set, this intersection was well linked. This intersection is well linked here, okay? Which means that you can take a green thing and make a large number of disjoint paths. Yeah, because I mean, this is Menger's theorem. If you don't have a separation of small order, you have got, and because it's Welling, there are a lot of paths. I mean, it's like Welling fix. Okay, so there's a lot of paths. And let's call this flow, let's fix some one flow Pij. Okay, let's fix one flow Pij up there. So what we have here, we have got this M trees here, and between any two trees, there's a large flow in B. But these flows like Pij and like P, I don't know, PQ, these two flows can intersect a lot. Yeah, we don't control how they intersect, okay? But the observation is that if we can select, like we have got this this trees, this red trees here, yeah? Let's make them red. Yeah, we have got this red trees here, okay? If we can find, okay, if we can find a, between every pair of trees, if we can find a path such that these paths are vertex disjoint between each other, okay? Then we are done if M is large enough, okay? Because if you can find these green paths between every pair and they're vertex disjoint, then you can make contractions. You can contract the red trees into single vertices, and you can contract the green paths into single edges. So you can contract onto the endpoint all internal vertices so that only edge remains. And you have got a large clique minor because the green paths were disjoint, the red trees are disjoint, and you get an MM clique minor. So if M is like K square and K is the size of the grid you're looking for, you're done because you have got M minor, a clique minor. So in particular, there's a grid inside it, okay? So this is very fine, it's fine. So we shouldn't be, I mean, so the remaining case is that we cannot redo. So you cannot select a path. I mean, so there's like, for every two trees, there's a lot of paths, disjoint paths, but you cannot select one from each of them so that then they actually end up being vertex disjoint, okay? So this is the thing that you cannot do. So let's try to make a quite brute force algorithm of selecting these green guys and see what happens if this algorithm breaks down. So the idea is that now we want to really use the fact that this linker, this Pij calligraphic are really huge to make sure that if you cannot really select these guys, then there's some two to this Pijs and Pij and PPQ that really intersect a lot. Maybe in this intersect a lot, we can find the grid, okay? So let's try to think about such process. And this process goes as follows. Like we'll go over all the pairs. Like, so we order these linkages, like there's M choose two of them, and we process them in any order, but like we fixed order, like this, I mean, this fixed order, and we process them one by one. And if we're looking at the linkage PQ, so we are looking at PPQ, okay, all the previous linkages, we already selected a path. And for the previous linkages, we selected the joint path. So we are processing one by one and we try to select this joint path, okay? So we select the path, and when we select the path, we discard from the future linkages, from the later linkages, we discard the paths that intersect because they are no longer useful, okay? So if we take PPQ and we select, like if we select PPQ inside calligraphic PPQ, okay, then from the later linkages, we will discard the guys that intersect this guy, okay? So that's the process. So we take the next linkage, select one path, and from the later linkages, we discard the useless guys now, the guys that are no longer, that we don't no longer need, that we can't select because they're not disjoint, okay? And we want to keep the other, this linkages, the remaining linkages still large and large so that we still have got a lot of options to select. Okay, we have got still a lot of options to select. Good. And yep, so that's the process. So what does it mean? Yeah, so that's what I said, that we pick one and we want to restrict to paths disjoint with these ones, okay? And what we want to have here, we want to like, these linkages, I mean, so there's like M choose, remember that M was K square, and they're like M choose two, which is roughly K to the four, steps here, right? So this is like a small number of steps for some notional steps, okay? So what we can afford, because we are aiming at 2 to the poly k in the end, I won't carefully measure, we can afford to like shrink these linkages by some f of k factor or c of k factor at every step, yeah? So we have got M just to k to the four steps, and if at every step like the linkage shrinks by a node 2 to the k or something like that, or k factorial, like that's still fine. Because if we start, because we started the construction with large enough true if, so that this large enough true if move says us large enough well-linked sets, so the sets AI are large enough, so this linkages are large, okay? So if we want, we are still allowed to say what it meant large 15 minutes ago. Yeah, so I want to say that I want this large enough so that within this m choose two steps, which is roughly k to the four, shrinking by something like, I don't know, k factorial, by a factor of k factorial at every step, will still not, won't exploit this linkage to death. Okay, so what I want to have here, I think of this being k factorial, what I want here is that I want at every step to select a path such that if from later, from every later guy, if I discard the not disjoint ones, I will still have got like 1/k factorial fraction or 1/k fraction remaining. And this is still fine because that will only happen for k to the four times. Okay. So that's the process. Yeah, I'm looking at the next linkage and I want to select the path such that if in later linkages I discard the intersecting ones, I mean, there's still 1/k factorial fraction everywhere remaining so that I can process the process, and in the end I will select all the paths. So when the process breaks down, if I have got a linkage, whatever I choose from the linkage, there is some one later linkage where almost everybody intersects this guy, like only less than 1/k factorial fraction intersects this guy, not this disjoint with this guy. Like this guy intersects really a lot. Like, so for every guy I choose from my linkage here, there is one of the future linkages that almost everybody intersects this path. Okay. And this is the structure where I want to, use to actually construct the grid within these two intersecting linkages. Okay, so let's try to investigate there. I want to now tweak two minor issues if what I did, because that would be, I mean, these are like the technical things that are useful later. It's maybe not clear why I do it now, but there. But just cleaned up. The first thing I want to say is that I want to like turn C into C squared, or like actually take a root of C. So I want to keep my current link. I want to have got some, the current linkage to be slightly larger than the remaining linkages. Okay. So I want this one I'm looking at to be slightly larger than the remaining ones. And the shrinking will be actually by root C shrinking. So I want to select the path such that after shrinking, every later guy shrinks by a root C factor. Okay, so I select the path here, this guy shrinks by a root C factor. Then the next guy is of correct size, and from the remaining guys, I just discard some of the guys just to make it them smaller. So I want the current one to be slightly larger by some discarding step, because that would be useful. So the current one is slightly larger than the remaining ones. So root C became root C. This is not something up there. But the other thing that we'll be using later, I want to say it now, but that's used later, that when I go to the next step and I have got my next linkage and the future linkage, I want to reselect the later linkages. Because at that moment, I have got my current linkage, okay? And what was important, the important part was that, okay, these future linkages are disjoint with the previous paths I selected, okay? And they were large, their sizes matter, okay? They're like, they shrink at every step, but they're still large so that the shrinking process won't exploit them to the end of the process, okay? But then I want to reselect these linkages. So I have got my, I look at my current PQ, this is fixed, I don't touch it. But I take some later PIG, and I want to check if all the edges I added are really necessary. So let's draw a picture. So this is the PPQ. Okay. And there's somewhere here a linkage, blue linkage, PIJ. It goes from different place to different place. So it goes, but maybe it uses some of these paths. Okay, this is one path, maybe this is another path, maybe this is another path. Okay, this is PIJ. The other linkage, okay? And I want to clean it a bit. This is a step that's very common in many of these proofs, like this with linkages reading things. I want to limit. So this is the flow. And I want to ask myself a question, is the edge set, like the extra edges, the edges that are on the blue, so on the blue, but not on the red, is this set minimal to connect, like to have this three paths or this minimum number of paths from AI to AJ? Okay, so I want to say, hey, maybe actually using the same edges or using less edges, less blue edges, less blue, not red edges, I can also make a path up there. Because now if you look, I can take a finger and I can take this path and go like that. Okay, and this new violet path uses less blue edges that are not red edges. Okay, and this is what I care. I want the number of edges that are used by blue but not used by the red to be minimum possible. So I want to reselect the paths, reselect the flow, the related linkages, so they have the same size, but they minimize this condition. And this is like on this intuition, this makes this paths better behave, because now this path can also like shortcut like this. They somehow like intersect in more orderly fashion by taking this minimality step. We'll use it later in the proof. Okay, what does it really mean? That means that for every edge that's used in PIJ but not used in PPQ, okay, if I take all the edges of PPQ and I take all the edges of PIJ, but delete A, then I cannot know PIJ paths from AI to AJ. Yeah, so that if I take all the red edges and take all the blue edges and hide one blue edge that wasn't red, I cannot actually find the same number of paths. Like every blue not red edge is really necessary to find this flow. So like this is the property we get here. And I will try to argue, it may look technical at the moment, but this is a standard trick in the area to like force these two linkages to intersect in the neatly fashion so that they don't make a zigzag up there. And Michal will be doing the grid minor theorem proof for planagraphs, which is a bit different, has got much better bounds in 3 weeks or 4 weeks. I mean, there's Easter on the way there, so in a few weeks. And he'll be using exactly the same trick there to make a clean, to make cleaning at some moment. So this is like a well-known trick. Okay, so there are the two subtleties we are going to use here. And yeah, so we had our process. So this process, we just augmented at the moment so that I actually like shrinking step is root C, and I discard another root C function from, so that the current one is slightly larger than the other linkages. This is like a stupid technical issue, but there's just the minimality condition. And now I have got some moment when I stop, that means that I have got my linkage, and whoever I choose here, there's a later linkage I intersect a lot, like almost everybody. Everybody by one over root C fraction. Okay, so this is the process. And now what I want to do, and this is the main reason I kept the current linkage slightly too large, or slightly larger, is that I can actually look what was the main troublemaker later, and like restrict the current linkage only to the main troublemakers, like every path here has got the troublemaker later from which linkage they intersect a lot. And now there's only M choose two of them, which is like K to the four. So I just can restrict the current linkage to the like most common troublemaker. So I pick the later linkage IJ that is the most common guy that is intersected a lot. Okay, so I have got this situation where actually I have got PPQ that I will now call P. And I have a PIJ, this troublemaker later that I will call Q, okay? And now at the moment I have got that for every P in P, P intersects at least one minus one over root C fraction of Q. A lot of, almost everybody from Q by a small fraction, okay? And now I want to say that now I want to everybody intersect everybody. I don't want to like intersect almost everybody, but I want to say intersect everybody, like every from P intersects every from Q. And now, how do I do it? I just do it greedily, okay? I mean, this was huge things. So I want now to have got, okay, so this PPQ, even after this restriction, is still large. This PIJ is huge. So what I want to do, I want to take one path from, from PPQ and discard the non-intersecting guys from the other one and discard the non-intersecting guys. Take this like P1, then take P2 in PPQ and discard the non-intersecting guys from the other thing. I can continue this ones for roughly root C steps. Yeah, before I discard everybody, because at every step I discard only 1/√C fraction of the original flow before, so I can continue it for root C steps, like take a path from PPQ and discard the guys that are disjoint. Take another path and discard the guys with disjoint. So we'll actually get like P, I can actually get PQ of size roughly root C, but C was anything like K factorial squared or whatever we choose at the beginning. So actually we can think of these two flows to being very large. I mean, this is like, yeah. So I just do a greedy step and took some paths from the one from one set and some paths from another set, and they pairwise intersect. There are, I think, wiser ways of doing this step, but we don't care at the moment because we're just aiming at any reasonable relation later. Okay, so yeah, so this we can get these two flows of C root C, which is still large because we are free to choose C any function of K we want. Okay, good. So now we need to make an order, and now I will be drawing much more than better. Now I want to make an order. So we have got these two flows. I mean, there's the blue. I mean, let's make, there's a blue, which is like Q, I think. Okay, let's make Q blue and Q red, and everybody intersects everybody. So if on this picture they intersect like that, I mean, we have got our grid. Yeah, this is our grid. Yeah. But this is a very specific picture. So up there, it may actually happen that I have got Q. Okay, and actually the P does something like that. Yeah, this is one path from P and this is another path from P. Maybe now it jumps and it goes. I mean, that can intersect, but maybe it makes a jump, intersect something. So it can be like very messy, okay? And now we'll harvest our fruit. We'll use our this minimality assumption to say that it cannot be too messy. Okay, we'll use our minimality assumption that the intersection cannot be too messy, and we'll be actually extracting the paths up there. Okay, so what do we have? Let's draw another in the other direction. Let's draw, I think I need to draw the minimality was, I want to draw the blue guys. That was my, yes, I'm drawing the blue guys. Okay, so this is Q. Okay, and let's pick one path Q in Q. Yeah, that was the path. Remember that this was contained in Pij. Okay, one, and this was will be like a sort of a yardstick in this process. Okay, and pick an edge. Okay, maybe well, it's the other way around. This goes there. This, if you continue over this path, you go along this path, you intersect all paths from all the red paths. Yeah, there are paths from calligraphic P. Intersect and P is large. Okay, so let's split. Let's take some parameter that will be obvious later what we want. I think it's, let's call take some parameter B. Okay, and let's think of the following. Let's look at the first place when we have so like size of P over B paths. I mean, still still should be there. Yeah, let's take the first E1 is the paths that already you have seen here, like 1/B fraction of the red paths. Okay, this is the first path E1. Then you continue and then you mark E2 when you say a new fraction of 1/B guys from the red paths. Okay, and this continues from like you can do it like B-1 times EB-1. Then so that you actually, I mean, at every step, there are like B new guys you intersect. There's actually B new guys you intersect, okay? B new guys you intersect, yeah, and up there, okay? So yeah, so this is how, and now I want to use this minimality. How does this minimality say? This minimality says that if I delete one of this E in, okay, I lose an index, but E alpha, so if I delete E alpha, so what do you mean that the edges, this minimality said the following, if I take the edges of PPQ and I take the edges of PIJ, but I don't like E alpha, I don't like E alpha. I won't find, there's no Pij paths, Ai to Aj paths. That was the minimality condition, yeah, that we are aware as mean as possible on edges that were that are red but that are blue but not red. Okay. And I want this path. I can take these edges to be not red edges. I mean, I draw them red here. That was a mistake. They should be like I say orange. Okay. I take them. I mean, because intersecting a path, I say that they took an edge once I intersected 1/b fraction paths from P. I mean, I can wait until like the paths I just intersected leaves me and they take the next edge as the next separator. Okay. So the orange guys are not on the red paths. Okay. So what does it mean? That means that, I mean, I use now Menger's theorem. Yeah, there's a separator S alpha. There's a separator S alpha, which is of size smaller than P. I removed one edge. There was a flow and removed one edge. So now the flow is one smaller. So it's actually of size exactly Pij minus one. There's a separator of size exactly Pij minus one that separates Ai from Aj in this graph, with these edges. Okay, so that separate up there. Okay, how does this separator needs to look like? Like this is this blue guys and the extra guys from Pij are like flow is the flow up there. Okay, and you just remove this edge, say this edge. This is E alpha. Say. Okay, you remove this edge. That means that this separator S alpha, it needs to be one vertex on every path. It needs to be one vertex on every path. This one is one vertex on every path from Pij, but not on Q, because on Q you lost energy, but on not this path Q here. Okay, this path. Okay, so one vertex. And for every E alpha, you have got the separator. There's separator, this is separator EB1, SB minus one, this is separator S1. Okay, and these are like separators up there. And what I want to say here, I want now to make a twist to the previous one. I want to say that, okay, in the previous one, I mean, I could have got P, let's go to the previous one. I want to have Q large. Okay, let's go up there. What I want to say here is that I want to I want to say that the number of orange guys, I mean, okay, so let's look at the one red path. Let's look at one red path. That's one of the path counted here between E1 and E2, okay? And I want to say that this path can actually use one of these things, okay? Can actually use one of these things, okay? And what I want to have here is that I want to have, okay? So one use as well. So I want to have one of these red paths that don't use it. So I want to say that I can assume that P over B floor is larger than the size of Q. Okay. And previously they were of roughly the same size. Okay. They were of roughly the same size. But I can select Q smaller. I mean Q can be just smaller. So I select P to be like roughly size root C, but I select Q to be smaller, and actually Q equal K square is okay. I just select Q, I mean, at the end, I just can discard some of these paths and just keep only K square of them. So I need only K square of them at this point, okay? The number of Q is very small. So there are like only K squared vertices up there. So I want this, and so think of now that blue linkage is much smaller than the red linkage, okay? And now I will choose B, I choose a B to be, I think also K square. So B is also roughly K square. So B is also roughly K square. So I'm choosing B, no, B is, sorry, B is a lot. B is a K factorial. So B is like roughly K factorial. So I choose B large enough. So now this root C needs to be much larger than something like K factorial times K square. So that still, if I partition P into B roughly equal sets, like how many guys intersect, I mean, they can be exactly equal sets, how many guys we intersect, then actually in every batch of the guys intersecting here, there's like more paths than the orange intersections here. There are more paths than the orange intersections here, which means, but now this guy intersects here. So it's after E1 on this blue path and before E2 on this blue path. What do I want? I want to say that this path that doesn't intersect the orange guys, it needs to intersect between these two separations. Okay? So what I want to say here is that, hey, there's like the separation S1, a separation S2, and there on the, in this area, the red paths that intersect, there are much more red paths than the orange guys in S1 and S2, okay? Which means that one of these paths, I mean, can intersect the separators, and the separator separates AI from AJ, yeah? So this red path needs to be before S2 on this, up here, or before S2 on this path. Okay, it needs to be before on the AI side of S2 and on the AJ side of S1, okay, this red path. Which means that it needs to intersect every path from calligraphy Q, like every blue path, for every blue path, this red path needs to intersect it before S2 and after S1. Okay, because it needs to be on the AI side of S2 and AJ side of S1. This in particular forces the on every path, the orange guys to be in the correct order, in the same order as the edges on the top path. Yeah, that I, there's a first vertex of S1, then vertex S2, then vertex of S3, etc. Because there's a red path that intersects this path like on the before S2 and after S1. And there's another red path that intersects before S3 and after S2, etc. Okay. So this is the picture we got. This is still not the end. Because now what we, I mean, this is like the thing when you use minimality. Now I think I want to go to the another, so I should have prepared two empty slides here, but I didn't. So I will go into the, I have got notes prepared here, notebook prepared here. So we have got this picture that actually there is like, we have got this case where, we have got this K-square paths that were Q, okay? And there's actually some orange separators here. Okay, there's some orange separators here. I will draw them like that, okay? And between every two separators, there's a red path that intersects all of them, but we don't know in which order. So this path may do something like that. This path can actually jump here and jump here, intersect here and then go back, jump here and go back, yeah? So it, I mean, we don't intersect, I mean, and this can just go straight or something like that. Okay, and this is a lot. I mean, the number of this thing, the number of this mass is a lot, like much larger than k factorial. We'll do something like around k factorial here. Okay, so I have got this picture. Now we want to make an order. And now there's not much complicated we do. Okay, so we look at the connections. Like, let's, if you think about this path, you can, I want to like classify this red paths according to the, like, the intuition now is as follows. There's like a bounded, as a function of k, roughly k factorial, ways how this path can intersect the blue path. What does it mean? I follow this blue path and like draw an edge, like make thicker an edge whenever I jump to a path I haven't seen before. Okay, so first this is I haven't seen before, this is I haven't seen before, then I went around, then this is I haven't seen before, and this is I haven't seen before. Okay. In this path, okay, I first jump here. This is I haven't seen before. So it's like 1 to 3, then 3 to 5, then 5 to 4, and then 4 to 2. Okay. It could also happen. Let me draw an example. That, for example, I go like that, then I went back, and then I jumped here. Okay, there's no intersection here. So this is an intersection, this intersection, this intersection up there. Yeah. So now it will be like 1 to 2. Then to 3, and then from 2 I jumped to 4, maybe then jumped to 5. Okay, so it doesn't need to be a, like a path connection, it can be a tree. Yeah, so if every path I can make this tree, that's like they follow this path, and whenever I join the new path, I make an edge that there's actually a direct connection from this path to this path, and this is like a tree. Okay, this is a tree, and this is a tree with k square labels. There's roughly, okay, this roughly k square factorial such trees. Okay, because there are k-square labels, roughly k-square factorials. So if this was large, if I make it k-square factorial, whatever, to start from, I can actually say, hey, there's like a lot of them with the same type, with the same tree, yeah? Because there's a lot of these columns here, this was this parameter B from the previous slide that we could make seed very large. So if there's a lot of them, there's like some of these columns that have got exactly the same type, this tree, okay? And now I want to say, hey, I have got the same tree, and this is tree of size k square, and I want to say that it either has got a tree of size k square. Now I want to make another, like this type of brute force argument. What happens if this tree has got a subpath of length k? So let's take a color pink, and let's say that, so there's this tree, and say that there's actually a subpath in this tree of, I mean, I don't know, it contains 1, 3, 6, 7, 8, 10 of length k. Okay, so say there's a subpath in this tree of length k. Well, then we are super happy. What does it mean? That means that our path or a column has got a connection from 1 to 3, then a connection from 3 to 6, then a connection from 7 to 8, from 6 to 7, 7 to 8, 8 to 10. And now if you have got this path with these connections, yeah? If you have got this path with these connections, like one, I want to say that now 1, 3, 6, 7, 8, and 10, this rows, this blue rows, this will be my rows of the grid. And for every column, for every path that behaves like that, I'm ignoring everything else. I'm just taking the connection from 1 to 3 as an edge, connection from 3 to 6 as an edge, connection to 6 to 7 as an edge, and the connection from 8 to 10 as an edge. And this will be one column of my grid. Okay. So in some sense, I'm contracting all this internal paths, so that leaving only the orange things, I'm contracting these things up there. And from this red path, I'm keeping only the connections from 1 to 3, from 3 to 6, from 6 to 7, 7 to 8, and 8 to 10. Okay. So I need only K columns now of this type. Yeah. I need only K columns of this type. Okay. Yeah. But that was with the assumption that there's actually like a path of length K inside this tree. But there's like, let's go down, but there's actually it could have been that with this flow path, this red path, I mean, it could draw something like that. It could go there, go there, go back, go there, go back, go there, intersect, and go back, okay? So this tree may literally be a star, okay? But if you think about it as follows, like if you have got a tree of size k square, but there's no path of length k, then you have got more than k leaves. Yeah, if you have got less than k leaves, you need to have got something deeper, okay? So there's not, then they have got at least k leaves. Maybe there's like omega, I would write here omega of k square. I mean, that's like a simple tree argument that if you need to have got either, like there, you can think of them as partial order. Yeah, the tree is partial order, like parent, ancestor, descendant. So if you have got the chain or an antichain, yeah, this is like, yeah, so you have got more than k leaves, okay? More than k leaves, and you can use an amount of leaves there. Because what I want to do, now I want to use the fact that, I mean, I cannot use this path to make all these connections, I mean, up there, but I want to use this path to make one connection. So what I want to do here, now I want to have these leaves as my rows of the grid, okay? So I have got, yeah, so I have got my, these are the paths that correspond to the leaves, okay? And now if I have got this red path, what does it do? At some moment it visits one of them, then goes back to some other paths, then visits this one, and then go back to some other paths. And it doesn't visit any other in the meantime, yeah? And then it goes, and maybe at some moment visits another one because it's a leaf, and then it goes back, okay? That's like, how does this red path behaves? And now I can use this red path to just draw this connection. Okay, and then I can use the next red path, like later red path, to draw this connection. Okay, so I'm not using one path because this I'm not using one path to make connections. They can be like in different. Okay, the order. I mean, the trees are the same, but the orders can be different. Like another red path can have got different order, visit the leaves in different order. Yeah. So what I'm just doing here is that I'm using different red path to make like only one vertical stroke of my grid. Yeah. So the blue things will be contracted into rows. And now from K consecutive red paths, I make one column. So like every or K minus one from every red path, I use only to make one connection of my grid. And that's it up there. So I mean, it's enough for me so that now the number of orange guys of the same type is K squared, so that I will make all the horizontal paths of my grid. And I'm done. So that's how I construct it. The important thing, I mean, the exact details of all the like steps are not that insightful. The important part was like the overview. If you remember, the overview of the proof is that, hey, we started with this welling set and we squeezed as much as possible from the Robertson-Smith approximation to say that there's a welling set and there's some spanning tree, subcubic spanning tree of the other side. We said that, hey, actually, we're trying to construct a grid minor with this kick minor. And the reason why we fail is that there are two linkages that intersect a lot. Okay. And we want to extract a grid from two linkages that every path intersect every path here. But it wasn't easy to start from. We used this, the main trick here, because it's not really easy to say that if there are two linkages and everybody intersects everybody, then actually already there's a large grid minor. That's not easy. That's true, but it's not easy. The main trick here was to actually area or select these linkages so that the difference is minimal. So like the later linkage has got as few new edges as possible compared to the earlier one. And that gave us the structure with this yardstick that actually they're somehow neatly ordered, that you can select like neatly ordered set of red guys. And once you select this one, it was like hitting with like pigeonhole principle a few times to get it up there. Okay, so that's the grid minor theorem with the like exponential bound proof. The polynomial one is more complicated, so I want you to only know that it exists. And I think I'm done for this lecture. So if there are questions to the topic of the lecture, that's a good moment. Otherwise, I will stop recording now and maybe answer a tutorial question because there's one on chat. Okay, I'm stopping the recording and then we can continue this.